Hello, and welcome to Northwest Indiana Community Art Association's presentation of local accomplished professional artists. Today's presentation features the work of artist Gene Lewis. We hope you enjoy the wonderful and in-depth stylings of artistry from the imagination of this artist. And now, Gene Lewis.
Hi, I'm Gene Lewis of Gene Lewis Fine Art. I'd like to tell you what my life was before I became Gene Lewis of Gene Lewis Fine Art. I was an art teacher, K through 12. I started out at my own grade school district in Harvey and stayed there a few years, went on to Matson, and then toward the end of my art career, I finished up in high school. And when I retired in high school from 2010 it was, I decided I knew what I wanted to do. I wanted to create my own art. It was a dream deferred. And I have never looked back. I've started drawing and doing pictures from photos of family members. And then I eventually went on and started taking classes to really boost and enhance where I was with my art, because I'd been doing, you know, art with my students, and got into pastels. And before that, I was working in just about all of the mediums, acrylic, oil, graphite. But when I got to pastels, I realized this is the medium of choice for me. And so, like I said, I've never looked back. I love working with them. They are pure color in a stick. You don't need any solvent. You don't need any medium. And it's very forgiving. And so that's where I have been for a few years. And I have, if you'll notice the paintings over here, they all are people of African descent. And I have always loved working with the human figure. But when I discovered that a friend of mine, whose husband is the founder of Zakat Foundation of America out of Bridgeview, Illinois, he and his company go to different countries, and these people here are of from Kenya and Mali, and they do lots of things to enhance the life of the African people that they see. This non-for-profit helps with education. They build wells with female empowerment, and of course they supply food and just about everything that needs to be done. So when I saw the pictures that came from their helping them, and I was so in, it just really drew me in. And when they tell me the stories about the pictures, and they told me that I could use some of the pictures, it was, that was a day I'll never forget. So I use these pictures and I make them my own now when I make the pieces. And I'll explain what I'm talking about when I get to this point here to show you about these eight. They're all pastel, and they're all basically the same size. It makes for a nice presentation when you do that. And the pastels are all on pretty much the same paper, UART paper. It's a form of sandpaper, really, because those layers that you put the pastel on really do cling to it. And I'll show you my pastels in a few minutes. But let's look at some of the pieces. This one is of a little boy, and I call it Windows because of his eyes. And when I first saw him, his face just spoke to me. I don't have a real detailed story behind him as I do most of the others, but this was truly one where the emotion on a person's face spoke to me. And I knew that I had to work with that. So his look, the colors, his expression, it generally draws people in just the way it attracted me when I saw the source photo. Let's go over to the one next to him. This is a picture that had lots of people in the photograph, the source photo. And they were all standing around a newly built well that Zakat Foundation had built. And she was just a small person in the group, but it was something about her, shrouded in that you know, headpiece that she had on and standing near the well. And so I decided to work with her. And in working with her, because I like to take artistic liberty a lot, I decided to make her pregnant. And that was odd because I had to change her from being the old woman that she was in the photo to a much younger one. So I call this in waiting because she's, you know, expecting a baby. And I like to take African kente cloth designs sometimes, and I use some of them to work up the surrounding areas in the corners to kind of frame her even more. And I like the little light on her nose. I think that's what attracted me to her in the photograph, the little light that hits on her nose, and she looks like she's in a, she's thinking in deep thought, and I like that about how it brings the whole piece together. Let's jump down to this young man here. I want to say something about this because it's a comment I heard from someone while I was working on this piece. And now let's remember, my people come from Africa. The source pictures come from Africa, where there's lots of poverty, lots of need. And someone commented once, your pieces, the children don't smile very much. And I had to let that person know that they didn't smile because oftentimes there's not a lot in their life that's happy. Zakat comes to town and they do things that are nice. And in the case of this young man, they gave him this new coat he's wearing. So he's happy. And he's holding on to that pole. I don't know why, but I called it holding on because of what he's doing. Sometimes the title just comes right out at you. And this is one of the smiling faces that I like to show because, yes, they may not smile a lot, but when they're happy and they show it, you know, I want to key in on that too. And this is what came out of that one right there. He's wearing the new coat that he got from Zakat. All right, this one here is the second one done of this gentleman here. The first one I did, now he's in, it's called Drums, and he is sitting in front of a little makeshift lean-to, if you will, and all those behind him are handmade drums that he made. The previous picture I made of him, he was actually playing one of the pieces that look like that, where they're slats and he was hitting them with handmade objects. But now he's taking a break. And what I like about this piece, he's dead center. We're looking straight on. And then there's that network of fingers that always seems to attract people when they're looking at my piece. And the play of light, the hat, the hole in the hat. And a lot of people are drawn to this one piece. And I have to mention that last year, this time, I entered it into a show that the Pastel Painters of Chicago put on, and they wanted to show the work of their emerging artists, which I guess that's what I am, an emerging artist. And anyway, it won third place, and I was really proud. I was very, very pleased with that because the guy who was the judge said he just kept coming back to it. He found something that kept drawing him back to it. So I was pleased with that. And Drums is, it's about a year old now. This one is a mother and a daughter and a grandchild, I should say, and grandmother. And what attracted me to the photo was the light. I mean, light just gives you the form. Light gives you everything when it comes to working with art. The focus, I like to jump on that. And that's what's happening here. You can see the respect that she just looks like royalty, if you ask me. She looks like a respected woman and the way she carries herself. And the young girl behind her, you know that there's a connection there, but I like how she's looking at us. So anyway, I call that generation love. Over here, that's one of those young girls that I guess my friend or associate was talking about. They don't smile. Well, she's not smiling. And her family owns the white container that you see there, and they take that and they go down and to the well that was built by Zakat, and they get water for their home. And she went down with the family to get the water, and she lost her shoe. And so I thought that was I don't know, kids are kids, right? And so she's sitting there and she's looking at us, and I want you to see that. She doesn't look happy, but it's okay because we don't know her circumstances, but we can guess that she came from a very poor family if they had to go down to the well and get water. So anyway, that's what that one's all about. Now, this one is probably my favorite story, the one on the bottom. It's called The New Toy. This young man is from Mali. He's sitting on the ledge of his school, which is really poverty stricken. Okay, you can tell the peeling paint and all that. And kids who live in poverty, the first thing their parents do is to provide for them with food and clothing and things like that. Certainly not get them toys. But kids will find a way. And he went and he found a stick, or some sticks, a couple of sticks, and some string and an old tire. And he built his own toy. And he's proud of that toy. It's dark, but if you look closely, you can see that there's a little smile on his face. There's some satisfaction in knowing you've accomplished something like that, and especially when it's something that's special, you know, like having a toy that you know your parents couldn't afford. So that's one of my favorites. And this one has been exhibited in Cape Cod, Massachusetts. And so I was very pleased with that they found in it what I was trying to show, that the young boy was, he was proud of what he's done. All right, so I want to show you another one before I round the table that has been sold since I bought it, since I made it. This is a print of it, and it was called Crowning Glory. And Crowning Glory was about the size of these. And this was another young girl. She had a group of people behind her, and I took the people away because I just wanted to focus on her. And I also took a little liberty with her hair. She had the braids, but I put the strings around them and highlighted her hair and things like that. But her face, the beauty of her face came through from the source photo. I tried to make that really show up. Her eyes just really captivated me, and the way the light hits her mouth. So anyway, this was a picture that was sold from Highland Park Art Center. And the way it was sold was kind of surprising, because I went to the open reception, and the next day they called me and told me that a couple from Los Angeles had bought it that night and that it was up to me to ship it to them. So I'm like, wow, this is really something. And then when I called them, because I did have to call them, I found out they were actually from South Africa. My girl was going back home at some point. I was so pleased with the whole idea of it, but it doesn't end there. This is what's so good about prints and reproductions. I had copies made, obviously, of the prints, but also, now you have to look past the background color on this because they are differently, but I like to make note cards also. Note cards are my least expensive, product, but people buy them. The color is different from the background, but that's just one of the problems that happen sometimes with the different printing companies. But the essence of the picture is here. And I like to make cards so that people who maybe can't even afford, one of the prints will get a card and get something that they can take from, my studio from an exhibit and have it until they can afford something more expensive. Anyway, someone bought a card and they wrote in it, sent it to a relative in New Orleans. A card just like this. I'm sorry. The relative reached out to me. The relative was an associate professor at Tulane University. And she said she was about to write a book. And she wanted to know if she could use this in her book. We worked together for over a year. And when the book came out, Therapeutic Cultural Routines to Build Family Relationships, and it talked about the process of hair combing and how people get to talk and relate to each other doing things like that, mothers and their children. When the book came out, my piece was in it. I was so thrilled. So it was in the heart of the pandemic when all of this happened. But when the book was published, the author, her name was Lewis also, by the way. That's really weird. Her name is Marva Lewis. And like I said, she works at Tulane University. She wanted to have a book signing and wanted me to fly to New Orleans for the book signing and bring some of my prints and all of that, but it all fell through because of the pandemic. So she had a Zoom meeting because there's lots of contributors, female contributors to this book, and all of every one of the contributors were on the Zoom call, and they all had letters behind their name. They all were like esteemed individuals. And I was so in awe of them, and you know what? They were in awe of me. It just blew me away. It was a wonderful Zoom call. And Zooms are not my favorite sometimes, but that one was really awesome. Now, this young man dressed just like that was, the picture came from a crowd of people. He was at a celebration giving thanks to the Zakat Foundation of America because they had built a women's health clinic. And the village wanted to let them know that they were so grateful that they built this women's health clinic. So he donned his outfit, and I guess he's done this before, but he donned his outfit and he did a dance for them. And they loved it. They absolutely loved it. So when I saw the picture and I saw all of that was going on, I took him out of the scene that he was in and I put him here and I enhanced the color, the background. I decided to leave it kind of like Rembrandt would do in chiaroscuro, which means which you're emerging from the light. And I added some blending and fading of certain areas to also make it work for what's going on right here. And so anyway, Gambian celebration dancer I had on display in Nordstrom in Oak Brook. They had me there for an exhibit of my work, second time this year. And I had just got it framed, and 3 or 4 hours into the show, someone came in and she was just taken with it. And when her next words were, "Do you take American Express?" and I said, "Yes." And so it was a match made in heaven. I just really had such a good time talking to her. It was a woman who had two dental offices in Chicago. So my piece is going in one of the offices. Now, I showed you that one before I showed you what I'm working on now. I'm working on this one because it comes out of the celebration that the Gambian dancer did. When he was doing his dance, there was a crowd of people around him, children, women, old, young, men, whatever. And when you have music and you see someone else dancing, what do you feel like doing? You feel like dancing. And she broke into dance. And I just got this started. It's still quite a way from being finished. It takes me quite a while because I work and rework and whatever. But I just felt like I should show you this because this is my very latest piece. Hopefully in a month or so, I'll be done working a little at a time. And I will bring this all into, you know, the scene that I wanted to have. I'm still working up ideas. I had sketches at first, which is what I do in trying to work out what it is I'm trying to reach, what level I'm trying to reach with the piece. So I work up color sketches and things like that. So I got the color scheme, but I still have some things that I have to play around with and figure out from it. So, but this is what I'm working on right now, okay? All right, now I spoke about my works with the African people from Kenya and Mali. These, about half of them, are from people that I know. And I like to do that also. These two here of the young lady. Now, the one at the bottom looks a little different from the one at the top, but again, that's artistic liberty. It's the same girl, and I tweaked it. And she was in college then. She is a friend, neighbor of ours who lives across the street at the time. And when she came home from college, I hit her up and asked her, could we do a photo session? And she asked me to come over. And when I got there, she had outfits laid out. I was really surprised, but she had outfits laid out and she had her hair just the way I wanted it. And so we did some photos. And the one at the top, I had her standing by the open window. And again, light is important, and she's got just the perfect mood for that. I call this contemplation. And when I look at this, I like how her hair is working with, you can see that that part of it is hidden in the background from in back, and then the ones on the sides are catching just enough light to show you that she's got curls that are sticking out. The most fun part about doing this was the sweater. And it's funny because people think I labored over that sweater. And if you know anything about the word scumble, it's just like it sounds. You just kind of move the pastel all over the place. And I wanted it to have that Angora feel, that light feel, and that's what we got there. And the one down here, she put on a different outfit, and I called this Seriously. I actually called it Seriously. I just thought she's giving you that look that made you feel like that. Okay, so anyway, this was my neighbor. And you know what? I'm going to go on from here because that, let's fast forward to 2021. That was like 2016 or something like that. This one is the same young lady. And I bet you're getting all kinds of light there. But this one is called Tranquil Moment. She has graduated, and she was embarrassed because when we went out and I told her I want another picture so I can do another painting, she said, I got on the same sweater. I said, that's okay, not a problem. But that's a real girl thing, right? Guys wouldn't even thought of that. So I worked with that over a couple of months, and I'm very pleased with how that one turned out. I take this next week to Palette and Chisel because it's going to be in another show in August. But her hair, I just had such fun working with all the hair, the mounds of hair she has on her head, and then reliving that sweater. Reliving that sweater was a big deal for me. And working with her hands, I just feel good about that piece, I really do. Another family friend right next to her, a friend of my son's, and his name is Evan. And Evan, this is not the first time I worked with a picture of Evan. This is the first time he sat for me, but the first time I did his piece, it was from a photograph. He has been growing his hair out since high school. And so now it's like way down his back. And he came and sat for me last summer. And I really, you know, like how this one turned out. I had a couple of different pieces going, and decided to finish this one. This one has been out at Las Laguna Gallery in Laguna Beach, California. That one was sent out there. Okay, and the two at the top are from the same group as over on the other wall. They are from African Source Pictures, and I worked them up just trying to enhance what I wanted to, leaving out what I didn't think was necessary. The one on the left called Mother Love in the Motherland. I tried to show the heat of Africa in the background and putting cool color clothing on them to show contrast. And I just love the sleeping babies look on their face. So peaceful, so peaceful. And in contrast, the mother has kind of the little frown you have when it's very sunny. So anyway, working up the patterns on those was most interesting. And the young man over here, I call that Little Boy Blue. He is sitting on a rock, and I just kind of emulate in the background the breaking up of the space, as you might see in rocks and how they're jagged and things like that. But another smiling face. Okay, we got two smiling faces with children, so that worked out real good. Now, I talked about pastels, I showed you work. Let's look at actual pastels. Okay, well, we need to look at what it is I created all these pictures with, because they are the ones that do everything that you have seen. I do have a method though, you know, the pastels, or some think of it as colored chalk. Pastels have different hardnesses, if that's possible. Some are harder than others. I don't know if I said that right, but Rembrandts are what we start off with because they're hard by nature. They're made so that when you're laying down your base color, they can take the pressure, and they go on and give a nice base coat bottom to your artwork, where the other softer ones can then be layered on top of it. But all my pieces are started with Rembrandts. And the colors that you see here, I lay them out, I lay the palette out by mixing all the rest of my pastels together. The Rembrandts have their own box, but the rest of them, the new pastels, which are these thin ones, the Terry Ludwig's, and that's a pastel company that I just love. Now, this one is Terry Ludwig. They had a sale on blues, so I bought a box of blues. Now, I have some already down there, but they're very good. They're softer than Rembrandts, and they make a good second, third layer for working with your pastels. And I like the shape and size of the ones in the box of blues there. I work flat, or I work on the ends with it. Now here, I've broken them all up so that, you know, all the colors flow together. And eventually some of those might wind up over here, but that's it just gives for a nice palette and easy to find what it is you're looking for. These pencils actually are pastel pencils. So those are really good because when you're working with detail, fine detail, you want something like a pastel pencil point. And there's two different kinds I've got down here, Karen Diash and what was the other one called? And Carbothello, right? So I use both of them and some Derwents. They come in a lot of different styles and or sizes and types, let's put it like that. So I use this is what I work with, and I use a glove when I work on my right hand because pastels by nature are flaky, and I don't like that to get up under my fingernail, not my left hand, but on my right hand when I'm working. And as you can see, I do a lot of, you know, blending on paper just to see how things will work. You can do this straight on the piece, but I don't want, you know, a gazillion layers, so a lot of times I'll just try to make blending in the sketchbook or on another sheet till I get the colors that I want. And then I save those, like I've saved the ones on the tray here, and then use them when I need them. So this is the studio, and I came in December. And I have loved it ever since. My two studio mates occupy the other two-thirds of the room. It's a very long room. We get along very nicely, and it's nice to have someone to bounce ideas off of, especially when they work in the same medium that you do. And I just am so thrilled to be here in Union Street Gallery on the third floor in my art studio.